Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
All right. Hello, everyone. It's a great pleasure to introduce Andrea Montanari from Stanford. Andrea finished his PhD in theoretical physics in 2001 at Scuola Normale Superiore in Pisa, Italy. And he has been a postdoctoral fellow at Laboratoire de Physique Théorique L'École Normale Supérieure. Pardon my French. at Mathematical Science Research Institute, Berkeley, USA. In September 2006, he joined Stanford University as an assistant professor, and he has been ever since. He has received numerous awards, including SIGMETRICS Best Paper Award 2008 and CNRS Bronze Medal for Theoretical Physics in 2006. So today, he'll be talking about ideas from physics applied to computer science, in particular on message passing algorithms, a success looking for theoreticians.
So what this talk is supposed to be is supposed to convince you that this is an area in which there is a lot of interesting problems and a lot of interesting...
Mike.
Okay. Perhaps it's off because the button is off.
You want to try this one?
Okay.
Yeah. This one. Thank you.
So. Excellent. Okay, so this is.
I was saying.
The objective of the talk is to convince you. Is it on now?
Maybe not.
Is it on? No?
Is it on?
It should be on.
Is the green light on?
Yeah, is there a green light?
Yes. Yeah. Is it on?
Yes, it is.
Yeah. Okay. Okay, let's start again. So this is supposed to convince you that this is an area in which there is a lot of interesting problem, and there is some need for better formalization, and perhaps the theory community could get more involved in it and somehow find the right ways to formalize some phenomena that we have been witnessing. Okay, so I'll start with two examples. First example is for coding theory, actually. So this is one way of stating the basic decoding problem in coding theory for linear code. You are given a matrix. This is a matrix over the integers modulo 2, and the vectors, also a binary vector. And your objective is to minimize the Hamming distance between x and y, subject to x being in the kernel of A. Okay? So this is a very difficult problem. It's NP-hard. It's hard to approximate. There are some very structured class of matrices, say Reed-Solomon codes, for which you can solve it efficiently, but in general, the message that you get from complexity theory is that you should not hope for easy solutions in this field for this problem. And yet, people need to solve this problem every day. So this is just a diagram of this is a physical layer card in 10 gigabit Ethernet. So for instance, Christian, who is checking his email, is probably using, sending bits through one of these cards somewhere. And so this has a lot of blocks. I don't need you to read it. I don't understand it all. But here there is a little block. And this little block essentially its job is to solve that problem or solve some form of that problem. And here the dimension is 2048. And it does it, supposedly in 10 to the minus 6 seconds, right? So, okay. And what he uses some matrix A that is, okay, one can think of it as a random sparse matrix, to a first approximation. It's not exactly that, but the first approximation is a random sparse matrix, and it uses a message passing algorithm to do the decoding. Okay. So do not worry, I showed a hardware diagram. This is going to be the only hardware diagram, you know, so don't escape. I also am allergic to this thing. Okay, so second example, this is something on which we worked the last year. It's learning low-rank matrices. This has become, over the last 2 years, a very fashionable topic. And one reason why it's fashionable has been this Netflix challenge. So most of you know about it. Netflix is a company that rents movies. And 2 years ago, they released a data set. The data set was about 500,000 users and 20,000 movies. And it includes 10 to the 8 ratings. Okay, when you rent a movie, you can rate the movie. You give an integer from 1 to 5. So for instance, this is, Christos that liked the Lord of the Ring and gave it 4. Okay. So 10 to the 8 is 1% of the total number of entries. So this is extremely sparse. Okay. Most of the entries are unknown. Okay. And the challenge was, with this data set came a set of 10 to the 6 queries. So this is, user movie pairs for which the company knew the actual rating, but did not disclose it. Okay? So the company asked the researcher to, guess the values of these ratings as well as they could. Okay, and they promised a decent prize if you could do it with root mean square error below 0.8563. Okay, and
so this was my reaction when I saw this, because I thought this is going to be very easy. I'm going to solve the problem and win the challenge. And in fact, I couldn't.
But a popular way to do this, a popular piece in this, competitor was trying to fit a low rank matrix to this set of revealed entries. Okay. So what is the justification for low rank? The justification is that each user can be somehow characterized by low dimensional vector, and each movie can be characterized by low dimensional vector, and perhaps this is how much of an action movie it is, how many minutes Brad Pitt act in that movie, etc. And just the rating will be approximately the scalar product of these two vectors. Okay. So how do you do this fitting? One way of doing it is take the set of revealed entries, so this is Mij, subtract a low rank matrix that you want to fit. So here X and Y are two very tall matrices. Typically the rank is 20 or so. And then look at the root mean square error over all the revealed entries. Right, so this is what you would like to minimize naively. In reality, you need to add some regularization, otherwise you will overfit, and the regularization is typically the square of the Frobenius norm of these two matrices, X and Y. Okay, so this is called max margin factorization. One earlier paper on this is by Srebro, Reni, and Giacola. So how do you optimize this cost function? So this was kind of the description of the problem. The problem is now try to minimize this cost function. Okay. And the problem is that if this function is non-convex, and it's very high dimensional, right? In our problem, typically x,
the dimension of x and y
is the rank that is perhaps 20, times the number of movies that is 100,000, so you get a million variables. So you have a convex function in a million variables. How do you minimize it? Okay. So the way people did it typically is by some gradient descent. Well, you locally optimize the function and you find the local mean. Okay. So this is a small simulation. So this is the root mean square error that you achieve on the Netflix data set if you try to minimize this cost function. Okay? So here there are three curves.
this is the root mean square error that you obtain if you do, okay, this is a specific implementation of gradient descent, the black line. The blue line is alternating least square. Okay, what does it mean, alternating least square? If you look in x, fix y and look in x at this cost function, it's a quadratic function in x. If you look fix x and look at y, this is a quadratic function in y. Right? So one thing that makes sense is that, or that people try to do, is that I minimize over x, then I minimize over y, then I minimize over x. This is easy to implement again. This is the root mean square error that you obtain, and versus the number of iterations. And the third one is, you know, just a message passing algorithm that is as complex as this alternating minimization. Okay. So this is the value of the cost, and this is the value of the root mean square error. So here I had, you know, you want two examples, you know, that are from completely different fields, in which somehow people came up with, you know, kind of heuristic solution, and turns out that the best heuristic solution is related to this idea of message passing. Okay. Sorry? Yeah, so good point. You see, please interrupt me if there is anything. When you fit, you know, these entries, you can compute the root mean square error on the, you know, training set, or the root mean square error on a separate test set. Of course, the root mean square error on the training set, the set that you put in the cost function, is smaller. And the reason it's smaller is that the model is not correct, it's not a good model. If the model was the correct model, the two root mean square error would be essentially the same up to small terms, right? But the model is not accurate, therefore, you know, you overfit here. Okay. So, for instance, if you use a too large rank, or if you don't put regularization, this goes very, you know, becomes very low, but the prediction error, you know, shoots up. So this is a complex cost function that comes from an actual problem. Here, this is, you know, a fast way of minimizing. And I could go on all the 2 hours just with examples like this. Right? These are three books. This is a book by Daphne Koller, that is my colleague in Seattle, Stanford. I checked it on, I mean, I bought it, and I never opened it because it's 1,200 pages. And probably 2/3 of that is about this type of algorithms. This is a book in communications. It's, you know, 600 pages all about this type of algorithm. And this is a book about, you know, problems from statistical mechanics and large random structures that we wrote last year. Okay. So this is the outline of the talk. I start, you know, there is no, again, good formalization of all of this, right? Not completely satisfying. So I will take the point of view of describing an example, of following an example, and then following, you know, the ramifications of this example. And the example that I take is, you know, case satisfiability. Okay, so I'll start by describing a very simple algorithm for case satisfiability, describe how this algorithm is in reality a message passing algorithm. Then I'll take it seriously and try to improve this. Then I'll try to explain, you know, what can be proved about this type of algorithm. And finally, terminate with some recent application that I kind of like. And again. Yep. Hello? Okay. Okay, so case satisfiability, so I don't need to explain this here. So case satisfiability is the general problem. You have n Boolean variable, and an instance is a logical Boolean formula in conjunctive normal form, and k is the maximum size of any clause. Okay, so this is an algorithm by Broder, Friese, and Dupfel. I think this is, at least this is the people who analyze it. 93, and it's very simple. You look for a variable that is a pure literal. what does a pure literal means? Means that it always appears directed, that is non-negated, or always appears negated. So suppose that it always appears negated, you set it to false, okay? Then you can eliminate that variable and eliminate all the clauses that it satisfies, okay? And then you repeat this. So this is extremely simple. And in this paper, these people analyzed it for random satisfiability. This is, again, a nice example. It's just an example. It's a uniformly random formula with n variables and n alpha clauses. Okay. So there are so many formulae over n variables with those many clauses, I pick one uniformly at random. Okay. And these people analyzed this algorithm on these type of instances. And how the analysis goes, nowadays this is pretty standard. You first show that, okay, this is a Markov chain. It's a Markov chain in the space of, satisfiability formula, right? You start with some satisfiability formula, then you reduce it, you reduce it, you reduce it, and you do some random choices, so it's a Markov chain. In fact, it's a random chain, it's a Markov chain in a reduced state space. Namely, if you keep track just of the number of clauses of sides 3 and of sides 2, it is, in the number of variables, this is a Markov chain in this state space. So I don't need to keep track of the whole, distribution over all the formulae, but just of the distribution of a few quantities. And what these people did is, okay, it's a Markov chain in 2 or 3 dimensions now. I don't know. And it turns out that it's very well approximated, its behavior, large N, is very well approximated by some ordinary differential equation. Okay. So this is a method that was somehow systematized by Wormald, but it's very old. Okay. So this is a nice method. It's perfectly okay. It's just a bit heavy. In the sense, in the end, if you look at the paper, they do it only for k equal 3. And they end up with a very simple formula after a long calculation. Okay? So if you are of the philosophy that to get a simple formula, you should do a simple calculation, this is not a good proof technique. Okay? So I'll try to describe another proof technique. Okay? So the proof technique consists in looking at this simple algorithm as a message passing algorithm. Okay, so the first thing that I'll do is that I associate to my formula a graph. Okay, so this is a graph that has two type of vertices, one type of vertices that are associated to variables, and one of type of vertices that are associated to clauses. Okay, and I connect the clause to the variable if and only if that variable appears in the clause. Okay. So this is, for instance, the graph for this formula. This clause x1, x2, x3, not x3, corresponds to this part of the graph. So this node connected to x1, x2, and x3, and so on. So it's just a bipartite graph that has n vertices on one side, n alpha vertices on the other side. To completely specify the formula, you can think of adding labels on the edges that say that variables is directed or negated in that clause. Okay? So it's a labeled bipartite graph. Okay. Now, once you have this graph, you come up with some definition of messages. So this is what corresponds to the pure literal algorithm. I will have two type of messages. Messages from these clauses to variables and from variables to clauses, and each message takes two values. Okay, I call these two values free and constrained to just convey what they mean. So, for instance, message from here to here saying constrained, the interpretation is, you should, to satisfy me, you should take, some value. You cannot do whatever you want. Or free, the message means you can do whatever you want. I am satisfied by my other neighbors. Okay? And the same here, free means I'm free to satisfy you, whatever you want.
And constraint means I'm not free to satisfy you, so I cannot satisfy you. Okay. So the idea is that, you know, keep track of this iteration, you know, replacing the pure literal iteration with just an iteration on these messages. Okay. And T here denotes the iteration number. So what is the iteration that, you know, corresponds to the pure literal? Is the following. So look at the variable too close, okay, in which case it is constrained. Well, okay, first of all, I have to introduce one piece of information. I'll call in this way the label on this edge. I said that I can encode the formula in a graph if I put it on each edge a label that is a 0 or a 1 that tells me is that variable directed or negated in that clause. Okay, so I will have one such label for each edge of the graph. So how these messages have to be updated? This is one way of updating them. You just say, OK, the variable, in general, it will be free to satisfy the clause unless there is one clause that constrains it to take one specific value, one of the other clauses here that forces to take one specific value. And this is a problem if and only if that specific value is different from the specific value that would satisfy that clause. Okay? For instance, suppose that here this is directed and here this is negated. This clause might force this variable to take value false to satisfy it. And as a consequence, this is not free to satisfy the clause. Is it clear? Right.
The const here just means it's not.
Yeah. So okay. The interpretation is on top of that. One thing is, you know, this is just two values. I don't need to give an interpretation. I can define whatever algorithm. But you are right. The interpretation is, you know, free means you are pure, essentially. Okay, and okay, so this is the update rule here. The update rule here is, okay, so this thing is constrained, this clause constrains this variable always unless some other variable CL tells to the clause I am free. If the variable here tells to the clause I am free, so that variable, the variable J, can be used to satisfy the clause A. Okay, and therefore, you know, sets free I. Okay. So this is rules, you know, that I defined. Now, if you sit, you know, 2 minutes, each person in this room can prove that this is just equivalent to pure literal. Okay, and sorry. Okay, by equivalent I mean the following. I mean that, okay, the two are, you know, have a monotonicity property, both the pure literal and this update. If you look at the, you know, the fixed point, so the point to which converges, for instance, the following is true. You know, the pure literal, you know, eats all the graph, erases all the graph, if and only if this algorithm also frees all the variables. Okay? And if some variables are not free at the end, the variables that are not free are in one-to-one correspondence to the variables that, okay, the correspondence should be described for a moment, but are essentially in correspondence to the variables that are not pure, that are not eliminated by the pure literal. Okay. So here I'm thinking of doing the process in parallel, and the pure literal process is sequential. So you're right, the dynamics of the two are very different, and the analyses are very different, but I'm just saying that by monotonicity, both of them end up in a fixed point, and the fixed points are, you know, correspondence, that is more or less the correspondence that Ravi was mentioning, that is if a variable is set to pure at some, appears as pure at some step of the pure literal algorithm, it appears as free at some step of this algorithm. Right, so, okay, good point. Here I'm thinking of starting this algorithm by initiating all the messages to constraint. Mm-hmm.
So at the beginning, I don't know which one. So the definition, the full definition of the algorithm, I have to specify this update rule and initial condition that is all constrained. Okay, so now what is nice about this way of thinking things is that once you realize this, the analysis of this algorithm is just one slide. It's not one page, it's one slide. So this type of analysis, okay, as a name in coding theory, the name is density evolution, but okay, name do not matter. The basic idea is the following. I just keep track of two numbers or one number, but you know, for convenience, let me think of two number. So look at a random edge of the graph after t iteration and ask yourself, what is the probability that the message from j to a, from variable to close, is constrained on that edge? Call, give it a name, your favorite Greek letter, phi is mine, and the same for message from the close to the variable, phi hat. Okay. And now turns out that you can write, you know, a recursion for these numbers phi and phi hat. Okay. So let's try to do it together. Let's look, for instance, here. When is this variable constrained? Is always constrained unless it's free with respect to all the clauses, all the other clauses. Okay. Remark that here I'm setting up rules in such a way that message here only depends on the incoming message to other edges. So it's always free unless it's, it's always constrained unless it's set, it's free with respect to all the others. What is the probability that it's free with respect to all the others is the expectation of the probability this set free with respect to any of them to the power of the degree of this node. Here is, okay, this is the degree minus one. Sorry? Okay, so this will be next slide, okay? Believe me that is independent, and then next slide you'll see why, okay? So let's think that these are independent. What is the probability that this is free with respect to each clause? Is 1 minus 1 half, because there is this condition of the two S, the two labels to be the same or different, times the probability that is constrained. Remember, to be constrained, two things must happen. This guy must constrain variable I, and then the signs must be different, must be one directed and the other negated. So there is a factor half. And then I take expectation of this over the degree. And okay, in such a graph, the degree of a node asymptotically is Poisson. So let me just forget about small o of n, small o of 1s. So this is asymptotically Poisson. So you'll get the generating function of the Poisson. That is the exponential, so e to the minus k alpha over 2 phi bar. Okay. So here I just, I said what he was saying. I just computed this probability, if you want, assuming that all the messages incoming are IID with the probability given by this phi hat. Okay. And then there is a little calculation to be done that I did it in 1 minute, but the little calculation doesn't matter. Okay, so this is previous slide, right? So the beginning of the problem, you have one message on each edge, one message on each directed edge. This take two values, free and constrained. At each step, all the values are updated synchronously, and they are updated according to some rule. Now, I will not go once more over the rule, but the only important fact is that this rule, the rule for updating the message going through this edge, only depends on the messages incoming through the other edges here. This is one important point in the analysis. And the initial condition is all the messages are constrained. Okay? So this is, and morally, the way I guessed the rules, or somebody guessed the rules, is to make the correspondence to the pure literal. Is everybody with? The probability is over the formula. Okay. So now you can write the same, for phi hat, for the updating of phi hat. Here, the probability that this is constrained is equal to the probability that no other variable can satisfy the clause. Okay. So again, I take the product because I'm making an independence assumption. Okay. So this is my equation. Okay, it's not next slide, it's one slide after. I'm not postponing forever, don't worry. So let me just eliminate one variable. Here this phi hat is equal to phi to t minus 1 and put it there. And this is the recursion that you get. The new phi is some function, 1 minus exponential blah blah blah, of the phi at the previous time. Okay. And I have to start with everything constrained, therefore phi equal 1. Now if I plot this function looks like this. For small alpha, this function is 0. For alpha equals 0, this function is 0 because this is exponential of 0 is 1. 1 minus 1 is 0. So for small alpha is low. At phi equals 0 is always 0. So it's always 0. And as alpha increases, this function goes up. Now I have to iterate this function. Right, so everybody knows how to do it. Right, there is this kind of staircase. You start with phi equal 1, you map to the function, you map to x, and then you go down. So what appears here is that if the function is below the line y equal x, then this iteration converges to 0. If it is above y equal x, this iteration converges to some fixed point that is strictly greater than larger than 0. So what this means? It means that there exists this alpha critica. Let me call it alpha pure literal. So this is the largest alpha such that the line is below x. I mean, the curve is below x for all x in the interval. And for alpha less than alpha pure literal, the iteration converges to 0. What does it mean, converge to 0? It means that eventually in the graph, there's going to be no constrained variable. So all the variables are set free, and therefore you were able to solve the formula. So you're right. Okay, so again, one slide. Okay, people in this audience know the business, but so we almost, modulo these two observations that you spotted, we almost proved this theorem in these two slides, that pure literal finds a solution with high probability if alpha is less than this alpha pure literal, for which we found an explicit formula, and fails with high probability otherwise. Okay? So this, in the original paper, was probably a 5 pages calculation. It was a stock or Fox paper. Okay? So now, as you spotted, this is not really a proof. You have, really to add a few details. So let me argue that this is a proof, that modulo details. The first thing is independence. Okay? And independence is taken care of by the following fact. So let me introduce a couple of notations. Think of taking a random vertex in your graph and then construct the ball of radius t around this uniformly random vertex. Okay? I call this BIT. And then on the other hand, I define t to be some random rooted tree and TT the first t generations of this random rooted tree. This is your favorite random rooted tree, essentially. Okay? And now, so there is this definition that dates back to Benjamini, or Itai Benjamini and Ode Schramm in 96, and was greatly expanded and developed by Aldus and then in a review with Steele in 2003. But in this context, I'll keep it simple. the sequence of factor graphs Gn. So take, you know, you have these random graphs. For any n, you will have a random graphs generated by over n variables and n alpha clauses. Okay, so think of that. But any sequence of graphs with n vertices and edge set En, I say that converges locally to the random tree T if for any fixed integer small t, the ball converges in distribution to this first t generation of the tree. Okay. If I take just the ball rooted at a vertex, this is a random rooted graph. It's random because the vertex is random in particular. I can think of its distribution, and I can compare it with the distribution of the first t generations of this tree. And then I ask, does this distribution that depends on n converges to this one? If it does for any depth, I'll say that, you know, the graph sequence converges locally to the tree. Okay. Is the definition clear? Yeah. Okay, so it's not necessarily the girth that matters here, because one important point is that I'm rooting, you know, at a random vertex, right? So if there is a small o of one vertices that are in triangles, I will never see them. I will not see them asymptotically. Okay. So this is a standard definition. Now, again, any of you in 2 minutes can prove the following, that this random graphs converges locally to the following Poisson-Galton-Watson tree. Okay, so the Galton-Watson tree is the following tree. You start with a root, and then you sample, you know, Poisson k alpha over two clauses in which this root is directed, and Poisson k alpha over two in which it is negated. And then for each of them, you sample k minus one other variables. Each one is directed or negated with probability half. So here in this figure, directed is solid edge, and negated is dashed edge. And then each variable, I sample another independent Poisson k alpha over 2 for directed and negated, and so on and so forth. Okay? So this defines a distribution of a random rooted trees. It's a process that actually generates such a tree. I can take the first t generations, and the statement is that the ball around the random rooted vertex in this graph converges in distribution to this. And this solves the independence question, essentially. For any, you know, fixed, you know, trivially, for any fixed number of iterations, you know, what I will see is just a tree. Therefore, a message coming up of this node, for instance, of this node, of this edge, and this edge, since the algorithm has this directed property, message coming up this edge will depend only on the subtree here, and the message coming up this edge will depend only on this subtree here, and therefore they are independent because the subtrees are just disjoint. Yes? Wow. It's nice to have a smart audience. So in fact, a little more is needed, right? So there is one of the two parts of this theorem that I stated. There were two parts. One is alpha less than alpha pure literal, then you will be able to eat all the graph. Okay? Then that actually, you know, nothing more is needed, because after, say, a billion iterations, a fixed large number of iterations, you will end up with a very small number of, you know, disconnected components, and then you can satisfy that. Okay? The other part, there is a little bit more work to do. Okay? So this was done in this paper by Molloy, this work. Essentially, what it does is, you know, it goes back to the pure literal formulation, the broader free Zipf-Hall formulation. The great simplification is that now it, you know, so it runs this algorithm, this parallel algorithm, for, say, 100 million iterations, and then shows that at that point it's actually almost stuck. So if you do a little bit of, you know, pure literal, you have a drift that you make you stuck after a few iterations. So the great advantage is that now you have to analyze this, you know, this Markov process only for very few steps. Okay, and a very rough analysis is sufficient. Okay. So this is somehow putting together a bunch of ideas that, you know, somehow greatly clarifies and simplifies a result that was known. And in fact, it generalizes this result because, yeah. It's not the experience. Okay, so this was I was talking about to get 1 minute ago. So what I used before was the fact that your message coming up this edge and this edge are independent. Okay, but if the graph converges locally to a tree and you have this directed property, the message coming up this edge depends only on the formula here. So this will mean, you know, that for most of the vertices, you will eat them up, right? So suppose, for instance, you are before alpha pure literal. This is telling you that after, again, a million iterations, you are left with 0.000001 of the vertices, times n of the vertices. And that point is, you know, these are, with that probability, disconnected, and anything will satisfy them. Okay? Okay, so you know, not only simplifies the thing, but generalizes it a lot, right? Here, you know, I could have taken here this not to be Poisson, but to be any vertex degree distribution, and the analysis would have been just the same. What I have to change is just this generating function here, okay? This expectation here. All the rest goes through. So here, instead of the exponential, you'll have the generating function of this degree distribution. So in particular, this extends the proof to any graph that converges locally to a Galton-Watson tree of any type, and in fact generalize it to any graph that converges to what's called to a unimodular random tree. Okay. So now, one can say I don't care really about such generalizations. But the possibility of doing such generalization is a great part of the success of these algorithms, at least in coding theory. So this is a big success story in coding theory, LDPC codes. This little box in the 10 gig internet was actually an LDPC codes. So these were invented 40 years ago, and then rediscovered also thanks to the contribution of CS theory people like Mike Luby. So these are defined like linear codes. So these are subset of 0, 1 to the n that are the kernel of a matrix A. And the idea is that A is the adjacency matrix of a sparse random or pseudo-random graph. And so the great contribution of these people was just this, was to say, OK, I'll take the graph to be a random graph with a given degree distribution lambda and rho. What Gallagher had said 40 years before was, I'll take the graph to be a random regular graph. And it worked so and so. It worked well, but was not amazing. These people said, I can take any degree distribution and then optimize over this degree distribution. And the analysis is exactly the analysis that I did 1 minute ago. The analysis of the decoding algorithm is exactly what I did 1 minute ago, with some things to be changed. Okay, and once you optimize over this, then you get that these codes achieve capacity. So they are achieve the optimum possible performances. Okay. So now, what I would like to do is to go over a couple of connections with a couple of apparently different, notions or ideas. Okay, the first connection is the connection with Gibbs measures. Okay, so this is very interesting and very deep. So look again at this infinite tree. So this is a random k-sat formula that is infinite, okay, and it's a tree. Okay, and it's also random, but forget for a minute about that. Okay. I will take mu t to be the uniform measure over the solutions of this infinite formula. Right. Now, what does it mean to be a solution of an infinite formula? This is easy to understand. What is not easy to understand if what it means to generate a uniformly random solution of an infinite formula, right? Because if you have a finite number of variables, you can say you take just every solution with probability 1 over the number of solutions. If you have an infinite formula, the number of solutions is also infinite, if there is any. Okay? So this problem, you know, how to define these things, okay, this was done in statistical physics, and the way to define uniform is to say, okay, I'll say that a measure is uniform, or Gibbs, if when you look at the conditional distribution of, you know, okay, let me call, so this is just the variables that are up to generation t, and delta t is just the variables that are exactly at generation t. So I'm saying it's uniform if, when I look at the conditional distribution of what is up to depth t conditional to what is at depth t, this is uniform for any t. This is the way you define uniform measure for an infinite object. Now this is, you know, actually an easy theorem to prove that, okay, once you define it this way, what is not clear is that there exists only one uniform measure over solutions. In principle, there could be many uniform measures over a solution, many measures that are whose conditional distributions are uniform. Okay? So this is a fact, is that if you take random ksat, the uniform measure is unique if and only if alpha is smaller than some threshold, and this threshold is 2 log k over k, and in particular it's equal to the pure literal threshold up to small o of k minus, big O of k minus 2. Okay? So this is a bit of an exotic concept, but in reality it has a very concrete formulation. The very concrete formulation is that what happens up to the pure literal threshold, more or less, of this uniqueness threshold, is the following. Look at the conditional, okay, take, you know, a finite, the first t generations of this tree, and look at the conditional distribution of the root given whatever is at generation t. Okay? And now, okay, here there is a, you know, typo, this should be x prime. Okay? Look at the conditional under two different boundaries. Okay? And now take the sup of this difference over all the possible boundaries. So up to the pure literal threshold, or this uniqueness threshold, this difference goes to zero exponentially in t. So this gives a, you know, nice other, you know, a connection with a nice different concept. That is, I take again an infinite tree, and in a worst case sense, somehow, you know, value of, you know, a random solution of two different, you know, nodes become independent for large distances. Is this? So this is the root. This is the symbol. So here I'm looking at this measure. I'm looking at the probability that this is 1 when I fix the boundary to some value, or that is 1 when I fix the boundary to another value. So here there is a, so imagine that here there is a prime. Okay. So in any way you change the boundary here, you cannot influence the root. Okay? And the influence goes down exponentially. And I'm telling you that this is, you know, essentially the same as the pure literal threshold. Okay, so this is an interesting coincidence. There is an interesting connection now that one can make with the Monte Carlo Markov chain. Mm-hmm. So it's well known in Monte Carlo. Monte Carlo Markov chain, you create a chain and you want the chain to mix rapidly in time. There is a, you know, well-studied connection between mixing in time and mixing in space, so the correlation in space. So this is a notion of the correlation in space. Does this correspond to mixing in time? Now, the problem is a bit pathological here in the sense that the space of solution is not connected for some trivial reason, in the sense there might be one variable that you cannot flip from one value to another because it's the only variable that satisfies that clause. So just, you know, there are many ways to avoid these pathologies. One way to avoid the pathology is just instead of looking at the uniform measure of a solution,
I look at the measure that puts weight e to the min minus beta, the number of clauses violated by x on the assignment x. Okay, so for beta infinity, this is the uniform measure over solutions. Okay, so now you can define, you know, just in a straightforward way, a Markov chain that samples from this measure. The way you do it is that you pick a random vertex at each time, and then you sample it from its conditional distribution given all the rest. And the point is that the conditional distribution of one vertex given all the rest is easy to compute. So this has various names depending on the communities, called heat bath, Glauber dynamics in mathematical physics, Gibbs sampler in statistics. So this is a natural conjecture. This has mixing time polynomial below this uniqueness threshold, that again is about the same as the pure literal threshold. Right? So I'm not. Now, this is a conjecture, so I cannot quote a reference where this conjecture is proved, because otherwise it wouldn't be a conjecture. But this is a future reference. Elkanan and Allan, Mossel and Sly, have been proved that this kind of results over one model after the other. They didn't yet prove it for this, but I bet that if we insist with them, they will prove it in, you know, not long time. Okay, so perhaps it's a good time to. I spent 1 hour so far, so. Yeah. So perhaps it's a time. Okay, so perhaps we can stop a few minutes and then we'll do more complicated things.
And the serious stuff will start only in the second part.
Cool.
So, sorry about mic issues.
No problem.
Yeah, basically, I don't know. I talked to this guy who is handling it, and he said that it's all set on the maximum. You know, but people at the back can hear it, but it's you know, it's a little bit on the lower volume. You know, so I tried to fix it.
Okay. That's great. But I would fix the voice. I don't know, right?
It's a work in progress. Yeah.
This looks dangerous. What do you want?
Okay, I would like someone to go to the end and wave to me if the voice level is better or not.
Okay, that I can do.
Yeah?
Right. I was hoping something a little more Piotr-esque.
Test. This is lower. Test. Okay, so this one is.
This is very solid.
This is less, right? I see. Test. Test.
Can you talk to yourself? Okay. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5, 6.
Yeah. Let's play. 1, 1, 2. Yeah, but it's very... seems to be very...
Yeah, the mic is not very good.
One.
Oh, yeah, now
one. Yeah.
Yes,
yeah,
but
if
you put it very close, then it works.
Yeah.
I don't know what to do.
The thing is that I was sitting for like the first half an hour here, and I was able to follow. No problem, right? It just required a
couple of problems. Okay.
A
shout. Yeah, I prefer to shout than to use this.
Yeah. When you start using the mic, it's
Yeah, then one has to focus on keeping it close. Yeah, I don't know why, because this is the rhythm okay? I don't know about these tutorials. I don't know about these tutorials here, whether they should be more tutorials. I tried to make it pretty tutorial. Okay. Yeah. Yeah, I know. I don't know, but it's or those that couldn't understand didn't need to ask questions. No. We lost one screen. Perhaps you can ask Leonard. Leonard solved it before.
Did you have it before, this issue?
Yeah, but I don't know. Leonard solved it.
Leonard solved it. That should be projection, yeah.
That's annoying.
Okay, I think that I will need to don't take it off. Don't because it's gonna take some time to warm it up. Okay, I'll try to find it on that.
What was the
running Microsoft product? So we want,
I guess that problem is that,
yeah, last time I just turned things off and brought them back on.
You want to do that? All right, I guess it got stuck.
Trying maybe if you just take your stop sending a signal and then send a signal again, that'll be go faster, right? In terms of, you don't have a way of in software doing it. Okay.
Problem is that in my Yeah, they're coming. That now the laptop got stuck.
Now the laptop is?
Yeah, now the laptop got stuck. Yeah. I don't know why there are some projector that this Mac does it also with you?
Yeah. You're also a Mac.
Yeah, this is the only thing that. I'm not gonna start again from scratch. Yeah. Okay, so welcome back. So we did one algorithm and then a few connections with them. Now I'll try to take this idea of message passing more seriously and try to push it and see what happens, right? So this is basically the plan for the rest of the talk. Okay, so how would you do it in your dreams? It being, solving satisfiability, right? So honestly, one nice way would be to have a black box, call it marginal, that, given a, index variable index I, what it does, it returns this mu of xi equal 1, where this mu is the fraction of solution in which xi is equal to 1. Right? And of course, I don't know how to implement this black box. Right? But if I had this black box, what I would do is that I would repeat this cycle. I choose a variable, call this black box, compute this marginal, and then do randomized rounding, right? So fix the variable to 1 with probability mu of xi equal to 1 and to 0 otherwise. So this is great. This would be great because not only would give me a solution every single time, but it would sample one solution uniformly at random. Yeah. So, okay, good question. So this mu has to be updated, so it becomes the conditional probability when you fix the sum of the variables. And so of course I don't know how to make this black box, but what I can try to do is try again to use this message passing idea to compute these marginals. So how do you do it? Again you set up the formula as a bipartite graph. And then the way to do is to say, okay, messages now will not be two values, discrete variables, but will be probability measures, very simple probability measures over 0, 1. So I indicate the simplex of probability measures over 0, 1 in this. Yeah. It's just one number between 0 and 1. Right, so each message is, if you want, a couple of two non-negative numbers that add up to 1. And there is one for each edge. And now how I have to update these messages, this is the way I'm going to use, the method I'm going to use. Okay, here at the variables, what I'm going to do, I'm taking all the incoming messages and just take the product component by component of them. And then normalize. So I don't want to put
bright C's everywhere in my formula. So I indicate with this symbol equality up to a normalization. Okay? So I just take, you know, the messages incoming and I just take the product component by component. And at the closest, what I have to do, okay, if here, okay, I have to take the product of all these values. So this is the probability, for instance, that the message from J to A, okay, this should be, you know, is equal to SJA, okay? So here, you know, satisfying the clause, I write it as all the X's being different from the S. Okay, so I remember that I specify a clause by giving on each edge of my clause a value S, okay, that is a 0 or a 1. Okay, and clauses satisfy, my convention is that the clause is satisfied if the variable is different from the S on each edge. Okay, I can just write it in this way. So this probability is the probability that not of these variables satisfies the clause. So these are some, you know, a bit messy equations. Let me just try to derive one of them carefully just to show that, you know, that what is behind this equation is pretty trivial. Okay, so let me consider just one formula, a big formula that is formed by a big chunk plus one clause here. Okay? So this is clause A. And just for simplicity, I'll assume that this clause is x1 or x2 or x3. Okay? And now I call ng the number of solution of, you know, the formula g such that xa is equal to dot. Okay? So this is xj, ng xa equal to dot. Okay? And if I know how to compute this number, I know how to compute the marginals, of course, because the marginal of, you know, probability that xi is equal to 1 under the uniform distribution is the fraction of solution in which xi is equal to 1 divided by the total number of solutions. Okay? Now, let me try to compute this quantity. For instance, to compute the probability, you know, number of solutions in which this is equal to 1. Well, if this is equal to 1, it satisfies the clauses. So I can throw away the clause. So this is equal to the number of, you know, solution on the formula G minus A, in which the first variable is 0 and the second is 0, x2 and x3 are 0, plus 0, 1, plus 1, 0, plus 1, 1. So I'm just putting all possible combination of these two variables, x2 and x3, here. What is the number of solutions in which this is 0? Well, if this is 0, this is not satisfying the clause. So better one of these two to satisfy the clause. Okay, so that number is the number of solution of the reduced formula, g minus a, in which either x2 is equal to 0 and x3 is equal to 1, or 1 and 0, or 1 and 1. So there is one less term. Okay, so I can write it also as the number of solution in gx1 minus the bad term. And now let's take the ratio of these two quantity, the fraction, you know, of number, the number of solution in which x1 is equal to 0 over the number of solution in which it is equal to 1. This is equal to the ratio of the marginals, of course. The marginal in which x1 is equal to 0, the probability that x1 is equal to 0 under the uniform, divided by the probability that x1 is equal to 1 under the uniform. Just because each of these, this is proportional to that and this is proportional to this, right? Okay, so if you step back a moment, if you take the ratio of these two, this to that, you get a factor 1 because of this division, and then you get the other ratio that you can write just at the probability with respect to the residual formula, that x2 is 0 and x3 is 0. Now I get exactly the equations that I wrote in this specific example 1 minute before, if I just eliminate, you know, I just write this probability as the product. Okay. This is of course not true, but I can just, you know, set this up as an algorithm, pretend that it's true, and then see what happens. Okay, so this is the way, you know, now you have to do it, you know, for a general clause, for, you know, a variable with degree bigger than one, but this is the way you derive these equations, right? And the meaning of all of these messages is, what would happen to this variable if this clause wouldn't be there? This message is, what would be the marginal distribution of this variable if this clause wasn't there? Well, this again is an interpretation, needs not to be truthful for the algorithm to make sense. But it's good as a guiding principle. Okay, now, so this is, you know, a slightly more sophisticated algorithm that's pure literal. And what it does, at each step it chooses a variable. It computes its marginal, eventually its conditional marginal, and then fixes, you know, a variable to 1 or to 0, depending on the marginal, by doing randomized rounding. Does this make sense? So the idea is that this should be a bit better, at least, than purely the hoop. Okay? So the question is this worth the effort? We went from a very simple algorithm to a messier one, had to do some math on it. Is this worth the effort? Okay? Unhappily, there is no rigorous result that I can really say it confirms that. For instance, the following is easy to prove. It's not published anywhere, but it's easy to prove that, you know, look just at the first step at this algorithm, that is computing the marginal. Okay? So, you know, BP, so this belief, so this algorithm has a name, it's called belief propagation. I didn't invent it. You know, it's, you know, this 1,200 pages in, you know, Daphne Koller book are in part about this. So this BP, you can prove in this instance, that in this model, that computes the correct marginals below this uniqueness threshold, that again is 2 log k over k, and is essentially the pure literal. So the punchline of this result is this one, right? It's a bad result, right? You started with a completely trivial algorithm. You proved that it works up to this threshold. Now I came up to this notion of uniqueness and then this belief propagation, etc. And you can prove that it works up to the same threshold, right? And the proof of this, okay, the proof is, you know, just a general argument that will come in 2 minutes. And it's convenient to generalize. But okay, let's go back and ask ourselves once more, is it worth the effort? And since as a background I'm a physicist, sometimes I'm able to forget about theorems and do simulations, right? So this is the probability of success in this random case out of this BP algorithm, the probability that it finds a solution. Again, very simple, as a function of alpha. And you know, for different sizes, this is a few hundred instances, so size 1,000, 3,000, 10,000, 30,000, okay, seems to have a sharp threshold phenomenon at some alpha that is equal to 9.05. Okay, so below, so this is just a phenomenon, below 9.05, this, you know, message passing this BP algorithm finds a solution with probability that goes to 1. This is 4SAT. Mm-hmm. So we took 4SAT, we generated formulae, we ran this algorithm, it's very fast. Then we computed what is the probability of succeeding. Okay? Okay. So just to put this in perspective, this is where this pure literal threshold is for 4, is alpha equal 1.54. So this is up to the point up to which I can prove that the first step I can even not prove the whole algorithm will work, but I can prove that the first step computes the correct algorithm, the correct marginals. And this is the threshold up to which it works empirically. And there is also some theoretical argument, some analytical argument that gives the same threshold. Right, so there exists a formula for this number. Yeah. I mean, pure literal, you see, we did the analysis that we did before was a complete analysis. Before, it fails. After that threshold, with high probability, it leaves order n formula that you don't know on n variables that you don't know how to fix. Okay, so this is huge gap in a model, and this is essentially okay. It's not as good as it gets, but almost, right? Because beyond this threshold, this random forsat is with high probability unsatisfiable. Okay, again, there are upper and lower bound. There are non-rigorous analytical arguments. There are numerical simulations. This is one paper that has a conjecture for this threshold, there is little uncertainty about this point. Okay, and this is just before. Okay. Good question. So what happens as k grows? I heard this joke that in a talk saying good question is just an euphemism for saying I have it in the next slide. So for large k, the picture is the following. It's easy to describe. The satisfiability threshold is about 2 to the k log 2. This was proved by Akliopta and Perez. The pure literal threshold, we can compute it exactly, and goes like 2 log k over k. Okay, this BP decimation, again, there is no fully rigorous analysis. There exists a conjecture for it. And the conjecture is that it goes 2 to the k times e over k. It's a conjecture based on a very reasonable and very precise analytical argument, but it's not proved. Okay, numerically it works fine. Yeah, so this is the threshold below which this procedure of finding marginals and then setting variables sequentially works with that problem. Okay. So this is not that close to this threshold, but it's still an exponential factor in k bigger than that. Okay? Yeah. Okay, so there is a whole industry in proving things about algorithm, and the best algorithm asymptotically in k is actually by Koja Ogland, and gets 2 to the k log k over 2 over k. Okay, so gains a log k over this thing, right? What is very nice about this algorithm is that it just comes out a general principle, a very simple, a very straightforward general principle. So you can hope that whatever you learn on this algorithm perhaps will illuminate other problems as well on this problem. Okay, so I owe you now a general argument that tells you that below the pure literal, this stuff works. Okay. So I have to take a little detour for describing this general argument. Okay. And this little detour is needed to introduce one notion that is probably one of the most useful in analyzing this type of message passing algorithm. And the notion is a computation tree. Okay. So give me a graph, whatever graph, and edges have a color, say, just to make them distinguished. And this graph is rooted at a vertex. Okay. So the computation tree is a tree rooted at a vertex root. So here is how you construct it. You start from a root, then you add the neighbors exactly as in the original graph. Then you add the neighbors of the neighbors, but with the caveat that you don't backtrack. Okay, so for instance, here you go green and then dark red. And then from this you go to blue. Actually, here I forgot one, because here there is also a black one. Okay, so you follow all the paths in the graph, starting at root and not backtracking. This gives you an infinite tree, because in principle you can continue to cycle around. Okay, so TGIT is the first three generations of this tree. Okay, so who cares about this tree? Well, again, it's an easy exercise to show the following. Suppose that I take this tree, I think this tree, for instance, has, you know, a tree satisfiability formula that has a tree structure. Okay. Now compute the marginal at the root. Okay. Take, for instance, the uniform measure. If your model is uniform measure over satisfying assignment, take this satisfiability formula. Take the uniform measure of a satisfying assignment of this computation tree with T generation. This has some marginal at the root. Okay? This is this mu with respect to the T of Xi. I claim that what my BP box outputs after T iteration is exactly the marginal on this tree, at the root of this tree. And this is easy to understand why. Intuitively, it's just because, you know, this belief propagation argument doesn't take into account loops. So it works as if you were on a tree. Okay, so I don't know who made first this remark. But from this remark, you know, something follows immediately, something very general. So this was first noticed by Tatikonda and Jordan. Suppose that this Gibbs measure, so now you can take this tree, if you want, you can make infinitely many generations of this tree. You can look at Gibbs measures, at uniform measures on this tree. If the Gibbs measure on this infinite tree is unique, meaning that, you know, the boundary at any generation t influences the root only by an amount that goes down exponentially, then BP converges, okay? Simply because the marginal at the root of this tree converges. And if further the original graph has large girth, then the BP marginal that is equal to the marginal at the root of this tree is approximately equal to the marginal with respect to the original graph. Okay? And this should be pretty obvious. So if it's not obvious to you now, complain, because I should have explained things in such a way that it's just a proof by definition, right? The definition of uniqueness is just that the root doesn't influence the boundary doesn't influence the root, and therefore, you know, whatever is your initialization of BP doesn't influence, you know, what you get after T iteration, and this is what convergence means. And if G has large girth, means that the computation tree is more or less the same as the graph G, and therefore the error that you make in passing from this to this is small. Okay? And this is true for any model, essentially. It's not just satisfiability, but any model in which you can define this BP-type algorithm. Okay. So now one natural question is, what about graphs? You know, we don't like tricks. What about graphs with many short loops? You know, this theorem tells you that graphs without many short loops, uniqueness is a good threshold. Okay, it's the threshold for convergence of BP. So in particular, it proves my statement about random satisfiability, because random satisfiability, we saw that locally converges to a tree. So it has large girth around most of the vertices. Okay. So what about graphs that have many short loops? These are also interesting. Can we push these ideas in that direction? And one model that is, you know, nice to look at for this is just independent sets, just because, okay, what I'm going to talk about was first proved in this context. So what is independent sets? You just take a graph. You have variables that are 0, 1. And you look at the following measure. So here there is a mistake. So the measure is, forget this, you weight each configuration but lambda to the number of 1, and then you forbid two neighboring edges to be both occupied, to be both 1. So it's not different, it's just they must not be both 1. So it's different from 1, 1. So this is independent, weighted independent sets. And now we want to compute, for instance, this partition function, that is the weighted sum over all the independent sets, or we want to compute the marginals of this measure. Okay? So there is this very nice idea by Drawer-Bite that connects nicely to what I was talking about. So Drawer introduced this self-avoiding walk tree, What is this? Okay, I'll describe it more in a minute, but this is the truncation of this infinite computation tree. You truncate it at some finite level and you add some boundary condition. And the lemma is that if you do this truncation, the marginal that you obtain at the root is exactly equal to the marginal that you obtain on the graph. Okay. So before we had this problem that we, BP returns the marginal at the root of the computation tree, but we want the marginal on the graph. The self-avoiding walk tree tells you the following: you can modify the computation tree and get the two marginals to coincide. And how this computation tree works, this self-avoiding walk tree works, is exactly the same as before, except that each time you visit the same vertex for the same second time, you truncate the tree. So this is the whole computation tree for this graph. For instance, here, I started a path. I go green, and then red, and then perhaps black, and then red. In the computation tree, you would go down further because you can continue cycle, but at this point you realize that you visited already this vertex, so you truncated the tree. You truncate the tree and then it force these variables to be 0, 1, and there is a rule for choosing 0, 1. So it's a pretty neat construction. It's simple to construct. It's simple to decide this value. So this at first sight is amazingly nice because it tells you, you don't need to compute marginals on any graph. You just need to compute marginals on a tree. And compute marginals on a tree is easy, right? Because you can do it by dynamic programming. Now, unhappily, as you can see from this figure, if the number of vertices there is n, the number of vertices here is exponential in n. Okay, so you cannot really do this. So what is the algorithm? The algorithm is just, okay, I'll take this self-avoiding walk tree, go down for log n generation and truncate it, and hope for the best. What is the best that can happen to me? That you have uniqueness on this self-avoiding walk tree, that is, you have decay of correlation between the boundary and the root. Okay, so this is the theorem that proved on 2006. If G has bounded degree K, and the Gibbs measure on K regular tree is unique, then you can do this algorithm, can use this algorithm to do approximate counting in polynomial time. And what is nice about this is that, okay, there is not yet a proof of this, but this is likely to be an if and only if, in the sense it's probable, it's likely that if you don't have uniqueness on the K regular tree, then you cannot, unless P is equal to NP, you cannot count in polynomial type weighted independent set. There is work on this by Alan Sly. Okay. So one question is, how general is this strategy? I don't want to go over all the papers. David Gamarnik wrote several papers in which he developed a very similar idea independently. And the punchline is that it's pretty general. You never get this nice, very neat self-avoiding walk tree because this is really peculiar to models which have pairwise interactions and 0-1 variables. You get something a bit more complicated, and because of that you lose some factors here and there, but the basic philosophy is that this. So you have to use a more complicated, let me call it backtracking tree, just not to, but the basic philosophy is that this strategy is pretty general. Okay, so this is how general is this strategy. Since I started with some practical example, I can ask how practical is this whole approach. The complexity of this type of algorithm is polynomial, but the exponent of the polynomial, unavoidable depends on this rate b. I told you that you have uniqueness, again, this is x prime, you have correlation decay with some exponent b. And the level at which you truncate the tree, will go to infinity, will be a big constant times log n, where the big constant becomes big when this b goes to 0. Okay? So you don't get an an algorithm that is polynomial with a uniform coefficient, with a uniform exponent, but with an exponent that depends on some features of the model. Okay? So actually, so I put this quote in tiny font because it's not nice to advertise a paper of yours that is a failure. But we try to apply all these ideas to a coding problem, and there is no way to, we really worked hard. There is no way to improve over the simple belief problem. I mean, of course, there are models in which you can, but we try to do in a decoding problem, and it's very difficult because you have this explosion that is really dramatic. Okay, so one question is, so all of this shows you that there is this uniqueness threshold up to which these kind of iterative algorithms work very well. Okay? So they solve counting problem in polynomial time. We have this beautiful sets of results. There is still this big gap. Okay? Can we hope for more? That is, can we hope to one day to fill this gap or to prove something about this gap? Okay, so this is one example that we studied recently. It's not all equal sat. What is not all equal sat is like satisfiability, except that for each clause I also add the complement of that clause. Okay, so I have this, and then this must be true, but also X1 bar or X16 or X71 bar must be true. Right? This has some nice properties. And as before, I take the uniform measure over solutions. Okay? So this is one theorem about this with Prasad Tetali, is that take alpha star to be, okay, in this case is 2 to the k. So the behavior, for random, you generate a random not all equal sat exactly like random k sat, and the behavior is very similar, except that a lot of many of the proofs are easier. Okay, so take now alpha below this threshold, that is 2 to the k minus 1 times log 2. Then what you can prove is that if you look at the uniform measure over solution and the graph, this converges locally to the graph converges to a tree. This we saw is just the same graph model, and the measure converges to the uniform measure of a solution of a tree. Okay. And this up to this threshold that is much bigger than the uniqueness threshold. Okay? In particular, the satisfiability threshold was bounded by Acleoptas and Moore, and is essentially the same for large k is at the same point. So all the way to the almost satisfiability threshold, locally, the measure is well approximated by the tree measure. Okay. And the proof is not very hard. It's just based on the fact that in this case, the second moment method works. Okay. So it's not a hard proof. Unhappily, it's not as interesting as in KSAT, but it gives you some hope because it tells you that the measure on the graph is well approximated by tree measures way beyond the uniqueness threshold. And why is this happening? Well, because the fundamental reason is that the uniqueness threshold imposes some pretty hard constraint on the way correlations decay in your graph. Okay? What it's telling is that, again, if you condition everything, all the variables that are away from my variable xi, so these are all the variables that are a distance r or more from xi, and you look at the marginal at xi, this goes to zero with the distance at which you condition, and this is uniformly over all x and x prime. So uniformly over all the way of setting the other variables. Okay, there are other notions that make perfect sense. One notion is instead of taking the soup here, I'll just sum over average over this boundary. This is one type of thing that has been studied within what's called a reconstruction of trees a lot. It's clearly weaker than that. And one other would be that I take a bounded number of variables, and I take the difference between the their joint distribution and the product of the marginal. So I take 10 variables, in my graph, and I ask, do these, 10 variables, are these approximately independent? Okay, so this is, the point is that this is a random graph, so I can say I take the first 10 variables is the same as I take random 10 variables. What I want to do, I don't want to take 10 neighboring, close variables depending on the graph, because of course they will be, strongly dependent. So the status of, more or less this field is that, we can prove, a lot of things, or people have proved a lot of things under these conditions, but things seem to, empirically, what happens is that seem to work up under these much weaker conditions. Okay, so what happens for KSAT, then I perhaps skip to, more or less. What happens for KSAT is that, there are conjectures for all these correlations, decay condition. This was this alpha uniqueness, and this is easy to prove that goes like 2 log k over k. In the case of not all equal SAT, we also proved, a conjecture on the extremality threshold, the second type of correlation decay. The same conjecture in the same case of KSAT goes like 2 to the k log k over k. So this is roughly, more or less, where our algorithm, our BP-guided decimation, fails. And then there is a third one up to which this other, the correlation between finitely many variables happens. This is just very close for the satisfiability threshold. And finally, there is the satisfiability transition. So all this notion are not one stronger than the other, just in a kind of weak sense, but they are, at least in these random instances, they are ordered in a very strong sense, in the sense that they are verified or not, depending on very sharp phase transition. I'm not a believer, but the best algorithm, the best algorithm that probably founds, satisfiability solutions is this one by Koja, and again works up to asymptotically the same threshold, 2 to the k log k over k. Again, there is, there is a big risk in mixing, algorithms with this type of phase transitions, but I people have said that. I don't want to commit. People, often have said that because of this kind of phenomenon, right? Because, what's happening here is something very mild, in the sense that it's really a worst case phenomenon. So shouldn't affect you too much. But what's happening here is that on average over the boundary condition influences the root. So it's something pretty dramatic. So somehow, there is information, there is information about the value that I should set node 123 that is contained in the shape of the formula very far from node 123. So finding algorithm that take into account the shape means the structure, take into account this property is pretty difficult, right? You should have some really some better idea than these local methods. Okay. 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 So perhaps I'll skip this. Well, let me just perhaps skip this. A minute mention that, okay, this whole threshold have, connection to this other interesting phenomenon that I did not mention and will not talk about, that is the structure of the same space of solutions. This has again been conjectured long ago now by physicists, and gradually, people are proving pieces of this picture. Okay. So I want just last 10 minutes perhaps talk about the recent kind of application that is different from this and which we worked last year or so. And it's interesting because it's again all the models that we looked for so far are models on random sparse graphs, if you want. This is not a model on a random sparse graph, and still you can adapt these ideas. Okay? So the problem is this noisy, let me call it noisy underdetermined linear systems. And is the following. You have a vector X naught, you hit it with a matrix A, and perhaps you add some noise W, and you get another vector Y. Okay? And your task is one to estimate X naught given Y and A. Okay? So I will not propose you any application for this. Practically, there is no field in engineering in which you don't try to do this at some point of your life, right? And recently, people have worked on this a lot in signal processing, for instance, but also in computer science, for instance, Piotr, Anna Gilbert, Mutu, and others. So as a relation with this idea of streaming algorithm, sketching, etc., and there is interesting interplay there. So there is one thing that is extremely popular reconstruction method is a Stanford product. It's called the Lasso. So the Lasso says the following: to reconstruct X, what you should take. So here the assumption is somehow that how are you open? This is underdetermined, so A is a fat matrix. So you have less equations than variables. This is the difficult point, right? So it's an underdetermined system. So how do you hope to, guess the value of the solution if you have some less equations than variables? Somehow the assumption is that the solution is structured, or it's simple. Right? And the very fashionable way of saying that something is simple is to say that it is sparse. Okay. So this is one way that Robert Tibshirani and then Chen and Don developed. And the idea is the following: you construct a cost function that is a convex cost function, and you estimate by taking the minimum of this convex cost function. And the convex cost function is somehow this is the mismatch error, so it's the L2 norm of y, the measurements, minus ax squared. Okay? So this is, if you want, if the noise is Gaussian, this is the log likelihood ratio. And then you want to put something that penalizes vectors that are not sparse. So one way to do it is to add coefficient times the L1 norm of X. Okay? And the idea being that the L1 norm selects many variables to be zero because it's non-differentiable at zero. Okay. So this is used a lot in statistics. There is probably 2,100, at least 1,000 papers on this. And it's very much used. It's very interesting. It's nice because it's a convex function, so you can do this in polynomial time. But there is, again, very little theory done on this problem, on this method. For instance, what performances should I expect? There are upper and lower bounds. And typically, the upper and lower bounds are up to a constant. In many cases, you need things that are sharper than up to a constant. You want to say where it actually is the least square error. Okay? Or another is, I can sometimes modify this cost function. I can put, for instance, a barrier that prevents my x's to be bigger than 10. I know, for instance, that my x naught to be infernal is never bigger than 10. I can put a constraint. It's again a convex constraint. Is that useful or not? And also recently people have started designing these matrices A, especially in signal processing, because it comes from some measurement system, from some microscope, from some camera. And finally, this is a convex problem, but often, if this is image processing, you're interested in solving it for 10 to the 6 variables, okay? So this in particular, there has been a lot of work in theoretical CS, in kind of low complexity algorithms on this. All right, so this is a little experiment. In this case, I'm gonna take this model and generate the data according to this model. But I'm taking A to come from some real data. I'm taking the signal to be plus 1 with some probability, 0 with some probability, and minus 1 with some probability, and the noise to be Gaussian. So this is what you obtain. This is done with A, the metric A, that comes from some clinical data that actually Mohsen was working on. And I plot the mean square error versus this regularization parameter for various sizes of the matrices. And each time I run an experiment, I put a dot. So you get some cloud of point. And here the matrix is, you know, n times small n, and roughly aspect ratio that is 0.6. So you have 0.6 as many equations as variables. Right? So you get some cloud. Can you make sense of this cloud? Right? So this is one prediction for, you know, where this cloud should concentrate. So if you look at these points, as the size gets bigger, seems to, you know, concentrate around the curve. And this is a calculation with no free parameter for that curve. This is a matrix that comes from gene expression data. It's very small, 85 by 200. It's from this nice book by Asti, Tibshirani, and Friedman on machine learning. Ah, so this is mean square error. So I take the L2 error, okay, between my estimate and the signal, the 2x0. So I set up the experiment in this way, because in this way I know what is the ground truth. So I take the difference, and then I normalize by a number of variables, and, you know, this seems to have some finite value. You know, there is a bunch of results that says, you know, for instance, by Candes, Rombanger, and Tau, that say, so this seems to concentrate around the constant. This kind of results tells you, okay, this is smaller than a constant, okay? But now we see that it's smaller than a constant, and we are trying to compute that constant. Okay, and see, sorry? So it goes up. It goes up slowly, but it goes up. So one use of this kind of curve is that you, in general, you don't know how to choose this parameter lambda. You want to choose it in such a way that your reconstruction error is minimum. This curve, this theoretical prediction, gives a way to select it. Yeah. Okay, so this is some gene expression data. It's a very small matrix, but seems to be consistent with this. Okay, so this is just taken by a standard textbook, probably the best textbook in this field. So this is a theorem with Mohsen. And the theorem says the following. Okay, take the measurement matrix to be a random Gaussian matrix, so a Wigner matrix, with, you know, normalized entry in such a way that the L2 norm of each column is approximately 1. Okay? So assume that your model is correct, and then solve these equations. So don't parse this for a moment. Don't try to parse this. These are some, you know, couple equations in two variables, tau and theta. Christos was saying, I'm not trying. But you feel compelled to do it. So. Okay, don't try to parse it, I can explain it. But are two equations that you can solve in Mathematica, two equations in two variables, have a unique solutions, etc. Then the limit, so this is the mean square error, is the L2 distance between the lasso reconstruction, it's not divided by n, converges as n to infinity to some number that is given by the solution of this equation. So this is the way I plotted these curves. I just solved this equation, we solved this equation with Mathematica, and we got this. Okay. So this is proved for Gaussian matrices. We think that it is true for kind of a broader set of matrices. For instance, it shouldn't be too hard, or perhaps it's hard, but we don't know how to prove it right now, but probably it's possible to prove it for Gaussian with IID entries. You know, probably with Gaussian on you know, sparse graphs. But, you know, empirically, you know, we did a lot of simulation with David Dono and Arian Malek. It works on a lot of instances. Right, so now I started talking about a completely different problem, and you know, perhaps half of the audience thinks that I'm completely crazy. But, you know, okay, so this is just the eta function. But You know, when you know one hammer, you try to use it when you can, right? So how we proved this? We constructed a message passing algorithm to infer X. Okay, this H is not there. We construct a message passing algorithm that, you know, is supposed to solve this problem. We prove that the distribution of these messages converges to some limit, exactly as we did in our first example on the pure literal. We had just this limit was trivial because of this locally tree-like structure. We do the same here, and separately we prove that it converges, the algorithm, it converges to the optimum of the lasso without probability. And once we have all this together, we put together and you get the theorem. Okay, so you don't only get the theorem, you get kind of an algorithmic proof of this theorem that a priori is a theorem in random matrices. Okay? Okay, and the algorithm has some interesting form. Okay, just, you know, what the algorithm has some interesting form is related to things that people have been doing for years. What the algorithm does, so this is one function that is called the soft threshold function. Okay? The soft threshold function is something that people in statistics know very well, is the way to estimate sparse random variables in Gaussian noise. Suppose that you have a sparse random variable, a random variable that is different from zero with probability 0.1, and you observe it in Gaussian noise. How do you estimate? You should apply this function for a series of theoretical reasons. And the algorithm, what it does is that starts with some estimate, computes the residuals, that is, subtract from the measurements the contribution of the current estimates, okay, and then back project with the transform of the matrix, the transpose of the matrix, add to the current estimate, and then threshold. Okay. So this is what is called sometimes match the filter. So you just, compute, multiply by AA transpose, and then you threshold. Multiply by AA transpose, and then threshold. What this whole message passing idea is adding this term. And now there is a lot of interesting thing different from whatever I told to you before. First of all, the underlying graph, what is the underlying graph? You have a Gaussian random matrix. The only underlying graph that you can think about is the complete bipartite graph. So it's dense. In particular, you have no local weak limit because all the entries, all the edges of this graph have a weight that goes to zero. This algorithm doesn't work with any edge variable. It works only with all the algorithms that we described before have messages that are associated with edges. These have messages that are associated to nodes. And despite this, all of this works and works just thanks to this very important term that is related to something that in physics is called the Onsager term. And this is the, okay, these are some simulations. This is, for instance, the maximum sparsity. This is sparsity. This is the level of underdetermination. So this is the aspect ratio of the matrix. Fix an aspect ratio and look up to which you can reconstruct. This is essentially the number of non-zero entries of your original vector. Okay? So look up to which number of non-zero entries you are able to reconstruct your original vector. Okay? So this is the green curve. The red curve is that what you obtain with convex optimization, L1 minimization. The green curve is obtained by this algorithm. It's called iterative soft thresholding. It's a standard greedy algorithm to solve this problem. And this dot dash there is what you obtain by adding this term. Okay. So this is one other example in which this kind of apparently lucky, but it cannot be always a coincidence, phenomenon happened. You start with some standard heuristics, you modify it inspired by these message passing ideas, and you get something that is significantly better, and in some random instances, essentially optimal. Yeah, if you think of the factor graph is the complete bipartite graph.
No.
Right. I don't have, of course, the right. I mean, the underlying reason is that, of course, here, okay, there is still some kind of correlation decay, right? Okay. So there are lots of things that I didn't talk about message passing. For instance, Gaussian graphical models are a subject in itself. In that case, you can show that, you know, for instance, belief propagation converges and is correct. There is a way of thinking about this that it's based on, you know, think of, you know, this belief propagation as minimizing some functional. It's called the beta free energy, developed with these people. And through this, there is, you know, a relation with convex relaxation. So one could give an entirely different talk on this topic. The punchline is a bit sometimes, you know, disappointing, because once more you get that after learning all this, you find out that perhaps it's better to forget about these message passing algorithms and use convex relaxation. So this is why I didn't give this talk. So all of this is about optimizations or computing marginals or solving constraint satisfaction problem. There is an interesting idea. I mean, you know, people are interested in solving other problems other than optimization. For instance, finding equilibria, okay, in a game on a graph. And one can think of, you know, can you construct a message passing algorithm that find equilibria? So this is a paper that does this for Nash bargaining by Yash Kanoria. And, you know, this seems to be a super heuristic in this sense. It subsumes a lot of heuristics that everybody knows about. It typically works better than these heuristics. It's very easy to optimize over and to design. I don't know any problem on which, almost any problem you can find out something like this. But in a way, all of the theory is very disappointing. Because for every single example, you know, which you can prove something about these methods, I can find a standard method that does as good, okay? Does as well as that. For instance, you know, counting, we can prove that this works until uniqueness, but in most of the cases, you know, MCMC works up to uniqueness. Optimization, essentially, you can always construct a convex relaxation that works as well. Right. So in this sense, you know, theory didn't explain why these things are so much so successful, so widespread, people like it so much. Yeah, it's just faster, but faster is important. So it would be nice to have a conceptualization of what, you know, a formalization of what means it's faster, right? We have some cases, like for instance, this case, this minimizing this lasso functional, I can prove that it solved this for random matrices. But you, as a theorist, should be rightly disappointed with this. We would like to prove this not for random matrices, but for some class, deterministic class of matrices, right? And yeah. So good luck. Thank you. Okay, yeah, so there is always a way to construct a standard convex relation. If you start from the optimization problem, there is one standard, you know, on a graph, there is one way, standard way of constructing the, so you substitute, for instance, in case at all the variables with that are binary with variables in the interval 0, 1, and the clause with the constraint, for instance, a tree clause has to be substituted with the constraint that the three variables have to be in the convex hull of the solutions of that clause. Okay, so this gives a convex relaxation of the feasibility set. Right, now, problem with this convex relaxation is that there is always one feasible point, so satisfiability is trivial. But you know, you can try, for instance, to take a random vector and optimize the scalar product with that vector. Right. Okay, and there are other things like that. Unhappily, in case art, nobody analyzed this, right? But in other cases, like more independent sets, or for instance, one independent set, one other is max weight matching. People prove the theorems of the form. BP converges if and only if the linear programming relaxation is tight. So, for instance, in the matching is the usual linear programming relaxation. In the independent set is the simple linear programming relaxation. You substitute x plus you put x plus xi plus xj less or equal than 1, etc. So there are some results of saying. But all of these results are, order, the algorithm in the sense, this belief propagation cannot work better than linear programming, right? Right, there is no such connection that is, fine. Okay, so I can come up with convex relaxation that can be a useful guess, but nobody has studied that. Yep. Right. No. I agree. So there are So this is one advantage. All these algorithms are very naturally distributed. Have very small. If you think of implementing in a distributed way in a network, have very small communication overhead, etc. So, and related to this is the fact that they are very easy to implement in hardware. Very easy to coding software, so there is a lot of practical advantages. Again, there is no formalization of all these advantages. So in this sense, there is no way of saying, okay, there is this thing that, if I want this kind of distributed computation task that I want to achieve, and this is the only strategy that I know that achieves it. It would be very nice to. Yeah. Right. Yeah. That's absolutely true. That's absolutely. Yeah. No. Yeah. Yeah. It would be nice to have. Okay. So this is a kind of an informal statement. That is the reason why we are interested in all this kind. It would be, nice to put it on a kind of firmer and more general basis, right? But of course, it's very nice that all these things are, very distributed. Right. So if you have another hour. I didn't take things really. Okay, I don't have slides. But there is this, this kind of hierarchy, for instance, for random KSAT. There is the pure literal threshold, then there is the threshold in which this BP-guided decimation works. If you try to find out why it doesn't work above that threshold, you find out that above that threshold, as you fix variables, what happens is that at a certain point, the system undergoes some phase transition, and BP doesn't work in computing the marginals anymore. It must correct marginals correctly at the beginning and overall the path, okay, of procedure of fixing variable. At certain point, it stops fixing variable, computing marginals in the correct way, because there is some phase transition. So, okay, Sarbet propagation is a way to compute marginals, more accurately, in that phase transition, taking into account that that phase transition is there, okay. So as an advantage over this algorithm. In fact, so there is a gap of 1 in alpha for k equal 4. So Sarbet propagation gets to 0.97 or 98 or something like that. So fills almost all of that gap. Okay. So now the way you compute more accurately the marginals is related to a picture to what this phase transition is and what the space of solution is. There and okay, so we can talk. Yeah.
Oh, okay, excellent. So this is a very good question. In reality, the right way of thinking of belief propagation is that is approximating your multivariable distribution by keeping track exactly of marginals of one variables and the pair of variables. Okay, it's not as Michel Tagrand said before. It's a corollary, but it's a non-obvious corollary. So it's not trivial to see it, but you are really keeping into account pairs, or in the case of k sat of k pools. Okay, so there is this idea of generalized belief propagation was invented by Jonathan Yedidi, etc., by Sam Freeman, and the idea is I take into account marginals of a subset of variables, a block of variables of size L, say, that are neighbors. Okay, now. So, for instance, your graph is a grid. One natural thing is take squares of variables, four variables over a square, and take into account that marginal exactly. Now it's not obvious how to from this intuition how to get an algorithm, but turns out that you can, and turns out that is also a very useful extension and very successful extension. Yeah, performs. Depends of course on the graph, but for instance, these things typically are very useful in kind of imaging processing stuff, in which the underlying graph, it's Markov random field that describes the distribution of a two-dimensional image. So the typical underlying graph is a grid, right? So you take into account little patches, right? So this works better. Yeah.